Hello and welcome to Aging Matters. This is a program that is sponsored by and provided by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. My name is Ann Barlet. I'm the Manager of Community Outreach and Education for the Area Agency on Aging. I'm excited about our show this evening. I think it's going to be some interesting information on a nutrition slant. And my guest that I have with me tonight is Janet Little. She is a registered dietitian nutritionist. So thank you for being with me, Janet.
Oh, you're welcome.
I'm looking forward to tonight's program. We wanted to, our program this evening is titled Bite Into a Healthy Lifestyle. And I think that that title is appropriate for everybody. Certainly, we're going to focus a little bit more on older adults, but it's certainly all the information we've got is certainly across the board and certainly something that we should all be mindful of. So we're going to start first. I have some, our laptop is set up here, so let's start with that.
Sure.
And as you can see, we've called it Bite Into a Healthy Lifestyle. And let me just get our next slide ready to go.
Can I just say something about that title, where it came from?
Oh, sure.
Well, the professional organization for registered dietitians is the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics. And every year for the month of March, we have National Nutrition Month. And every year we have a different theme. Okay. And this year it was Bite Into a Healthy Lifestyle. Because it really is a lifestyle, and I know we're going to focus on that tonight.
Right, and well, I think that's great. Thank you. Thank
you're
you for
welcome.
Sharing that, Janet. And so what is a healthy lifestyle? Coincidentally, we've got that up. So we talk about that a lot. You know, be healthy and eat healthy. So tell us, what is that? What do you say, or what are we saying here with what is a healthy lifestyle?
Well, we're looking at the power of food, the power of what food can do for you and give you. And by and large, many of us eat too many calories or too much energy from their food. It says fewer calories, almost like assuming that you're eating too many to begin with. And that may not be true.
Okay.
But for many of us, it does involve maybe just eating a little bit less food, therefore getting so much energy from your food. Too much maybe that you might need. We kind of look more at, although calories are important, we look at sort of the food choices and kind of let the calories take care of themselves. We look at the different types of foods and how many of those you need in one day to meet your nutrient requirements. So there's the informed food choices, which we're going to get into tonight. And then getting daily exercise, which I know everybody thinks gym, but not necessarily. Yeah. It can be using your large muscles. So that's basically what we're looking
at. As simple as walking.
As simple as walking, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. All righty. Thank you. And so we've, I don't know for how many people that the My Plate that we have on the screen is a new concept or an old concept. I know that I teach a chronic disease self-management class. And for a long time when we've taught some healthy eating and education, we've been used to the old food guide pyramids, so you had certain same kind of food items and choices, and they kind of showed that. But we've now switched to, and it's probably been into play a little bit, the My Plate, and it's telling us to choose My Plate. So why don't we begin with that, Janet?
Yeah, well, it was the USDA that developed the food guide pyramid, and people seem to find that to be confusing. So mainly because they couldn't, some people did fine with it, but other people found it difficult to relate it to how they ate.
Okay.
Or what their food even looked like when they sat down to eat it or when they walked around and ate it. So they converted that information that was in the food guide pyramid to, as you see here, the plate.
Okay.
With a beverage, which we have here is dairy, of course. And so if you know the food guide pyramid, you can see this will look familiar. You know, your dairy, which for many people, that's your calcium. And if you don't drink dairy, there's other places you can get calcium. But the reason dairy is there is for many Americans, that's where they get their calcium.
Okay.
And then fruits and grains along the top, vegetables and protein. It doesn't have to be in those separate categories, but in your mind, you have to think about them and you can mix them up and do whatever you want with them.
Okay.
But that's, if you think about those categories in the food guide pyramid, you can now see them on the plate.
And so we're, and it's basically showing again that mm-hmm. you still need all of those yeah. parts to have more of a healthy day, choosing something from all of those categories, right?
That's right. Well, okay. they all give you something. So okay. if you have a snack or of course your major food meal mm-hmm. events, you know, having a portion from each of those or as many of them as possible is a really good idea. Because okay. again, they all give you something.
Okay. Unique. So if we look at this My Plate, and they have it divided, they're not quite equal
right.
divisions on the plate. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about that on the left and the right with the fruits and the vegetables and the grains and the protein?
Well, they're different foods. Your fruits are very much the carbohydrate that's found in fruit, which is fructose. So it's mainly that kind of carbohydrate. All carbohydrates become glucose in your blood. But before they become that, there are fructose in the case of fruits. And fruits have a lot of vitamin A, vitamin C, other types of nutrients, but those are the two big ones. Your vegetables are not as concentrated in carbohydrates, but that's mainly what they're made up of. A little bit of protein and a lot of vitamin A, a lot of vitamin C, a lot of calcium in some cases. And that protein's okay. a whole different thing, and it can be an animal-based product, which is basically all protein, no carbohydrates, some fat, depending on what type of protein it is. And then you have your legumes, your beans, your black beans, your garbanzo beans. These are proteins too, but they're a mixture of protein and carbohydrate. Okay. Which are very, very different. And then grains, of mm-hmm. course, are mm-hmm. people look at that and go, I don't eat that much. But when you think about the wide variety of foods mm-hmm. that go into the grain group, it's quite a few, and we do tend to eat a good amount of them. And I did mention dairy. Mm-hmm. Our calcium for different age groups is anywhere from, depending if you're a child, 800 up to 1500 in some cases. And a glass of milk is going to have 300 milligrams of calcium. Okay. So if you, the best place to get a lot of calcium at once is milk or yogurt, but not everybody can tolerate that or wants
right,
that.
Right.
So you have to look at other places to get your calcium. And that would be some of these other foods on the plate, actually.
Okay. And obviously, you know, with the division and whatnot, and we talked in the earlier slide, the healthy eating was a little bit about portions.
Mm-hmm.
So if we look at this, they look disproportionate on the plate to each other. So does that relate to then, you know, how does that relate to what we should be eating to get a full complement in terms of our portion sizes and our portions of each of those items?
Well, again, they're totally different things. So it does, you do end up with, they're totally different foodstuffs. So like if you look at this, uh-huh. this is like an example of each of those things.
Okay.
Actually, I need to do
Turn
this.
Turn it around. Okay.
But I was talking about the protein, and of course, this is a 3 ounce portion of chicken.
Okay.
You know, you're talking about like a third of this is probably 7 grams of protein. And this has maybe 2 grams, and this has 2, and this probably has none. So there's a lot of protein in
that. And each of those different, the fruits and the vegetables?
There's no protein in this, a little bit here, but there's concentrated protein here, and that's why there is 3 ounces. There's actually some protein in milk as well, but this is your big one. Particularly your animal-based foods are going to be all protein.
Okay.
And the big difference is going to be the fat in them. So that's why they're different. They're just made of different things. And so to equal this out and to balance the what energy comes from these foods, and for these foods to meet your requirements, we've worked it out where basically you're looking at a 3 ounce portion. So that isn't, you know, your Wrangler special at all.
I was just going to say, that's not what some of the folks are used to.
No, people are used to far more than that, especially when you're older. We're looking at having protein at every meal. Your body cannot deal with or use all that much protein. If you gave it more than this, in many cases, depending on how big or small you are, man or woman, your body may not use all of that protein. It's better to have a good amount at every meal.
So a little bit like that, a regular portion size and something at each of our meals.
That's right. What you want to avoid really from, you know, age 40 on is you're not only are you watching your weight, but you're also looking at your lean body mass. And your muscles and your bones work together to be strong. And you want to avoid what we call sarcopenia, which is where your body mass, your own muscles become atrophied or less and less. You really want to keep that up, and that's where that healthy lifestyle comes in. So getting enough protein at every meal and being physically active will keep that body mass the way you need it to be. Moving and strong.
And then getting all the other things will make it overall a well-balanced, healthy, daily, I hate to use the word diet, but it is a daily way of eating.
Yeah, we like to use the word pattern. You could say pattern too. I know diet has the word die in it, so we don't like that. But we like to use the word pattern. Yeah, this is like a pattern. And again, your age, your sex, how big you are will determine how big your portion size is too. But this is a nice way to start out.
Okay, all right. So I think we're going to move from this. And what I wanted to do, I'll come back to that. Well, should we talk about the cooking tips right now? Well, we're talking about all of these things. We have this other slide talking about cooking tips, and I think the cooking tips were to aid us in then making this a little healthier in the way we're making the food, right?
That's right, and easier to make, too. I mean, I did say earlier, you know, we're looking at this all separate. It's like, oh, do I have to keep it separate? Not necessarily. It's like you can keep them in your mind separate so you're sure to get it, but I think that there's the photo of the kebabs shows that you're combining those foods on a stick. And, you know, maybe depending on your cooking equipment at home. You some of them have grills in it and kebab makers and that kind of thing, but you can also fire the grill up and make a really fun thing out of it.
And it does make it fun. I was just going to say, it makes it fun. And I'll just share a personal story. There are several of us in our family that have summer birthdays, all at this, you know, a couple of us all at the same time. And when we get together for our birthdays, our group always chooses to grill kebabs. And we have these huge, you know, containers of the different types of vegetables and the different types of meats. And so we have fun, actually. We all go, okay, mine begins with the mushroom and ends with, you know, so that is fun, at least for us to do that. So that's great. And then you have the steaming.
And, you know, and why grilling? Why steaming? It's not a fat-based food. It's not like, well, let's melt the butter in the pan. You know, let's get the deep fryer out. I'm not going to knock that, but it does infuse a lot of fat into it. So both of these are lower fat or almost like non-fat ways of cooking.
That's great.
I know in our family, you like the grilling. We tend to like steam. We just do. We like wet food and steam food. I don't like going outside and having the mosquitoes. My husband's redheaded and they love him. We stay in the air conditioning and we just do quick steaming, and I like that very much.
Oh, neat. Okay, and then we have two other suggestions of stir frying and roasting.
Yeah, and again, you know, even colleges, they'll have a stir fry station in the cafeteria, which I get a kick out of. We had two entrees and that was it, you know, but stir frying's a lot of fun.
and again, another way of combining those food items that's on our plate with, you know, stir fry. You've got a little bit of the brown rice maybe, and you've got your veggies and, you know, other things. So that's a great way also to combine all those.
Absolutely. I think your family would like something like that, because you could have those ingredients out and do your own stir frying. You know, you can choose your own combination too. You know, you mentioned roasting too. One thing about all of these, if you end up with leftovers, it's really good to plan ahead what you're going to do with them. And with a big roast, like a big turkey or something like that, one thing I recommend is that you slice it up right in the beginning. Like, don't just let it sit out. No, don't slice it, give it to everybody, and let the rest of it just sit there. Slice it all up. And the part that you haven't served, put it into a shallow pan and let it chill down. If it's really hot, you can just put it into an icy bath for a while just to bring that temp down so it's not steaming. Loosely cover it and put it in your refrigerator. If you want to reheat it, do so, and bring it up to 165 degrees internal temperature. But once Once you chill it down, so it's between 32, 33, and 41, mm-hmm. That's when you can do things like freeze it. A turkey, you end up with a lot of turkey.
Right.
Once
right.
it's chilled down, you can actually dice it and then put, like, this is what we used to do.
Okay.
We used to take like 2 cups of the diced turkey mm-hmm. and then put it into a sandwich bag or maybe a sandwich freezer bag. That's actually a quart. But anyway, we put it in this.
Okay.
And then that way it was all ready for soup. You could make a turkey chili with it or a soup. It was all ready. The hard part, the cooking and slicing was all done.
Well, it's nice. You know, mm-hmm. again, we go back to it's a format of the same portion size, but you've chopped it up and you know that that's either one or two. You can freeze, if like you gave the example of the mm-hmm. turkey for the soup, but you can also, in doing something like that, if you're a single individual or just two folks living at home, you can make those individual portions and put that in those baggies and then freeze that, then you know what you've got.
Absolutely.
And how many to get out if it's one or two of you. Okay, that's a great idea. Thank you. That's wonderful. I think that in talking, and I think in talking to different groups of people, I think one of the more common confusing areas on the My Plate, we kind of get the vegetables and the fruits, but I think one of the confusing things is the grains.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we hear those whole grain words, but you know, I really think this is a good time to clarify, you know, what does that mean? What are we looking for? How do we find it in a store, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, well, what you want is, if you take the example of wheat, you want a product that really uses the original wheat kernel and didn't refine it. In other words, it didn't take out all the brown stuff, the brown coating, the husk part, the wheat germ. It didn't get rid of all that and leave you with white flour. Nothing wrong with it. It's not like it's poison,
mm-hmm.
but the whole grain is where you leave that intact.
And that's the healthy part. Okay.
It has the, you know, the vitamin E, it has the vitamin, vitamin E is the big one, and it has more of your B vitamins. What happens when you really refine the whole wheat,
mm-hmm.
ending with white flour, is you get rid of a lot of the vitamins and minerals.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you ever see where it says enriched, they put the vitamins and minerals back in. So you get, a lot of people love that refined product. Very often, they look at that as moving on up. It's like that's good. It means that I'm more refined. It's something that some people strive for. So what the industry does is it gets rid of the original germ and husk and everything. Well, you don't eat the husk, but it gets rid of the brown stuff, and you end up with this white flour. But they put back in the vitamins and minerals that were taken out. The trouble with that though is you don't have as much fiber as you used to, and you have what you've taken out is the fiber that does not dissolve in water. So what that means is you have maybe a slice of bread that has one gram of fiber, whereas if you chose the whole wheat flour, the whole wheat bread, you have 2 grams of fiber.
Okay.
So you have double the fiber in one slice of bread.
All right.
And it just adds up, because most of us, we'll make a sandwich with 2 pieces
mm-hmm.
of bread, and
mm-hmm.
that's what that's all about.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I've got two things coming to mind as far as some whole, how do I find that whole wheat, whole grain product if I'm going to the grocery store?
Well, unlike several decades ago, the food label is much more sophisticated, much more informative than it used to be. And you have your nutrition facts on the wrapper, but you also have an ingredient list.
Okay.
And fortunately, this is very simple. The very first ingredient should have the word whole wheat.
So whole it just wheat says whole wheat. That's
whole wheat flour.
Okay.
That should be first. Not just wheat, because that's not whole wheat. That's just, it's wheat. It's flour made from wheat. But you want that word whole wheat.
Okay.
Now this one says stone ground whole wheat flour.
Yeah.
Sometimes when they use the word stone ground without the word whole, it really isn't what we're looking for. You've got to have that whole wheat two words in there, and you can just envision the original wheat grain.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what
the first words that we're looking for in that ingredient list on the food label of the product.
That's correct. And
okay.
It's just below the nutrition facts.
Oh, okay.
In this case, it's right here. Yeah, so that's what you look for.
And let's talk about some products that we can purchase that are that fit that bill of the whole wheat. You had something right here that was bread, I assume. Mm-hmm. This is bread, so we can get whole wheat bread. What other products?
Well, there's the brown rice, too. That's almost a similar story, where they take something that has some of the original, well, what rice has a lot of the similar things, the germ of it and the less refined product, and they take all that away and end up with white rice. So it's a similar situation where you've taken away something that has fiber in it and naturally occurring, okay, particularly minerals. Now, again, okay, some people like that. It's what they prefer, but that's what that is about.
And so I've also noticed in the stores that, you know, we're seeing more of, it's funny how they market it, too. I'm thinking the spaghettis, where mm-hmm, they say whole grain, because they make the box brown, too. It looks almost like,
yes,
your bread wrapper. Are some of those products are real whole wheat products? We just still have to look for those words, whole wheat, correct?
Yes, and you always look for those words, because the packaging is going to, okay, say what it's going to say. Mm-hmm. And you have to, this is almost, like you could say it's required to list the ingredients, mm-hmm, and that's where the true story is going to be. Uh-huh. So yeah, you look for the word whole wheat.
Okay, so that's
whole
the
grain,
key.
Whole wheat, 100%. You look for that,
and whole grain, whole wheat, 100%.
If you've never had regular, if you've always had regular pasta, mm-hmm, and the more refined type, that's a real leap to go from.
It is.
So what you can do is go halfway. You know,
so
have
mix
both.
The two.
Mix,
okay,
the two.
Okay.
Now you also want to make sure you understand how long it is, how long it takes to cook the whole wheat versus the regular.
Okay.
You might have to put the whole wheat in first, in the water first, to add the other, and you'll end up with them finishing at the same time.
Okay. I see something interesting in front of you. If we can go to this item, it's, from my angle, what you have on the little baggie just looks like little,
yep,
pebbles, little teeny,
they are,
grains.
they are teeny okay, grains. This is probably from Peru. This is called quinoa,
okay,
and it looks like quinoa to,
yes,
us. But it's quinoa, and okay, it's one of the rare grains that has all the amino acids we need. Typically, there's one of the essential amino acids that's missing, and this one has all of them. It's like a complete protein,
okay,
which is what's so neat about it. What you do with this, mm-hmm, I made this today. Here's the little pebbles, the original,
okay,
and here's the cooked product. First of all, I put it in a very fine mesh strainer, and I rinsed it. And actually, like, it's almost like little soap comes out. It has dirt on it of a certain kind. It has its own covering. And if you rinse it until the soapy stuff goes away, it's ready to be put in boiling water. And
okay,
it's almost 2, maybe even 3 to 1. The cooked product, how you know it's ready, is the grain gets bigger and then,
okay,
it opens,
that,
and
yeah,
these little tails come out, these little white tails. This is red quinoa, very often it's golden, but you can really see with this red product, the little white tails,
mm-hmm,
come out.
Yes, you can. Can we eat that just like that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
or
you
just
can.
Just like you would boil rice. You,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's a lot like that.
Okay.
And you can treat it like rice or even a breakfast cereal.
Okay. Oh.
Yeah,
oh,
I've had it that way. If you make a whole,
okay,
lot of it, the last,
yeah,
thing you want to do is waste it. So you can,
okay,
you can make it as, you can just put it in a bowl with cold milk. You can heat it up.
Oh, all right.
Make it like oatmeal. You can add it as a parfait with yogurt.
Oh, that's a good idea.
And even just on the plate.
And that. Terrific.
Even on the plate.
In the little bit of time that we have left, I'm going to skip the amounts. We have some cooking tips also. If they're interested, that they can give us a call or you a call in terms of cooking tips. Last but not least, we have a couple of sites that I'm just going to pop up. And they are, the National Nutrition Month has some things, and we've got an Eat Right site and the National Nutrition Month, and I wanted to share with everybody that they have quizzes and games. There's some articles on cooking tips for one, eating to boost energy, and more on all of these pieces of information. We could be here another hour.
Absolutely.
Janet, I think there's so much that we can learn, but I think this is a good start. For a good lifestyle, for a good healthy eating lifestyle. So I want to thank you for being with us.
You're welcome.
And sharing a little bit more about how we can bite into a healthy lifestyle. Thanks so much, and thanks for tuning in.
Yeah.